Take two.
Take two. That's tech for you. Let's just make sure you're going to do it. Come on. Come on. Okay, I think we're on.
So maybe I really don't want to do my speech and I blitzed the system. I think that's the only meaning we can take out of this.
Yeah.
Well, how about then, while we're waiting for everyone to join, a beautiful friend of mine made me this, and it's a DIY smudging stick that she made on the last full moon. Yeah, with roses from her garden. So why don't I just clear my energy a little bit, maybe? Because this is beautiful practice for me. It doesn't have to be perfect. I'm going to smudge you too, just in case you need some energy clearing. I'm going to smudge us. Oh, it's beautiful. It's lovely, isn't it? It's a gentle burn. All right. We get to come back down again. Thank you for your... And we get to smell. It's delicious. So Amanda, if you're watching, I have used it and I am using it. All right. Let me actually do my speech for you. And I'll just turn that down. And I'm going to take a drink. All right.
We've got you, Jules.
All right. I'm going to rest it here. I keep asking myself, why this? Why now? I mean, why this? Why now? And in truth, I don't know. All that happened is I stopped saying no and I started saying yes to my own soul. Okay, right, it said. And here we are. My heart poured onto pages, my soul's knowing shared. The thing with wisdom is, if it's true wisdom, it's a mix of philosophy and experience. And usually that experience is painful. Revelation is born out of pain. From revelation comes wisdom, and then comes revolution. I'm here to be an intimacy revolutionist. Though the root of that is not revolutionary. It's love. Possibly the oldest spiritual teaching in any book. Love. To be loved better, we must learn to be better lovers. Though that is hard. When we have learned love from our parents, from our childhood, from our culture, from our own often painful experiences, and from media. When all we seek as humans is to be loved for who we are, exactly as we are, in relationship, that gets hard. The very thing that attracted us to our partner will become the very thing that repels us. It's possibly the greatest cosmic joke set up for our own revelation, and consequently, love and lineage revolution. My mum always called my dad the manana man. There's always tomorrow. What she loved most became the thing most irritating, because when there's always tomorrow, there's never a today. And who did I marry? The manana man. The most chilled, relaxed, laid-back human my soul could find, except on a basketball court. You see, what we grow up knowing love to be becomes the blueprint we seek out in the world. For every bit of his cool, I was hot. For every underdeveloped area of my being, he was overdeveloped. We always seek our opposite and equal. We outsource what is undernourished within us until we can no longer. And at that point, we're called into pain and we'll hate them for it. And herein lies our revelation and revolution, if we stay for it. I'm the daughter of a yogi and a health fanatic. I grew up on kombucha, meditation, and breath work. Some of my fondest memories are of learning how to control breath in my lungs, move energy through my body, and some of my cheekiest are of peeking at my father's tantric sex books on his bookshelf, fascinated and yet unsure why. You see, I've always been a lover. I loved too much. I expressed too much. I went too deep. I was always a too much girl. Too beautiful. Too sexual. Too tall. Too much flesh. Too loud. Too honest. Too curious. Too deep. Too much. Be less, the world yelled at me. Be smaller. Be quieter. Slimmer. Just less. Less of whatever this is. But when we tell women, be big in the world, be you, and then we say, but not like that. Not that way. Be less. Be more of what we want you to be. We injure women in ways that can last a lifetime. Not knowing who they are or what they desire. So used to being in service, so used to making sure everyone else is served first and they eat the scraps left over. Worse. I worked with a woman recently who literally ate the scraps off the floor her children threw from their plates. When the feminine withers, her capacity to be a blessing force in this world dwindles with it. When the feminine leaves this earth, it looks like crops withering, land drying up and cracking, abandoned and uncared for. Air becomes dirty, clouding the sun and the moon, its people treated harshly, abuse and neglect. When the feminine leaves women, it looks like women withering, drying up and cracking, devoid of feeling and unable to connect, even to their children. Women and their bodies treated harshly, abuse and neglect. A pervasive cloud of emptiness and numbness takes over, unable to feel pleasure and no idea how to feel desire. And yet, be more masculine, our culture croons. Strive, be more, be greater, have goals, be rational, achieve. Don't feel, don't nurture. What a waste of your skills. We pay the feminine energy professions less. Nursing, teaching, childcare, and we invisibilize motherhood. Motherhood is the place intelligent women go to die. What a waste of your skills. Oh, I'm just a mum. When are you getting back? The way we feel about the feminine within us is the way we feel and treat the feminine outside of us. This applies to women as much as it does to our world. Women dying slow deaths that were never theirs to begin with. Breaks my heart over and over again. That's my why. I'm going to go for some Dutch courage at this point.
You're doing beautiful.
Okay. I've always worked with women. Their bodies, their stories. Their experience of life has always riveted me. Yet it is the very selflessness and maternal nature of the feminine that is why it is often goes unseen, unheard, and unappreciated. In a masculine world, a path of feminine reclamation has seemed like the most radical act of our time. A world that becomes too masculine has an impact on the relationship with ourselves, our partners, and our planet. However, what I began to notice in this world of feminine loving women was an equally as pervasive man bashing and diminishing. And yet I worked with these men also, the ones we berated. I married one who in his presence I've been recreated over and over again. And loved harder and harder again. I gave birth to one who I loved with such a capacity. I couldn't remedy the version of men I'd learnt and the version of men I loved. And so I listened to the stories of men. For the first time in my life, I began to see what I had never seen before. In a world that seems set up for the patriarchy and any masculine creature, it seems inexplicable to me that they too were hurting, and yet they were. These men that had hearts as great and souls as deep as mine. And the more I saw, the more I loved, until one day I realized I could see beyond the veil of our loosely held facades and behaviors and understand the needs and desires underneath them. I wrote this book because I've always loved. And now I understand what it is to be loved better, to stop focusing on what I want and instead focus on how I can learn to love better. And the miraculous thing is, when we love another human better, we are loved better in response. We are the teachers of love. Our children will become the leaders of our world, and what we teach them of love, of men, of women, will become what they seek in the world and how they treat it and all of humanity. Motherhood is not where women go to die. If all of life comes through women, why are we not investing more on women's health, care, and well-being? Why are we not safeguarding life itself? We take better care of what we know about, and what is not made sacred becomes shameful. So I'm here to honor the feminine as sacred, so we may take better care of her. And so I will share with you a few truths that led to the setup of my genius. I've never been very good at maths. Numbers swim in my head. But I can tell you the equation I worked out pretty young. Masculine plus feminine energy equals attraction. Where maths made no sense to me, what did was science and biology. I ate up biological pathways and the laws that underpin our natural world like they were ice cream. And I understood that there's a type of stability created when two equal and opposite forces come together. And at the same time, an insatiable attraction towards each other. When a positive and negative charge come together, they create an arc of electricity. Positive and negative forces create the magnetic attraction that underpins our entire universe. So I came to really understand that what you seek is seeking you. The attraction I desire is seeking me. The experiences I crave are seeking me. All I need to do is become the energy that attracts and excites the very circuit they are on. And that's what this book is. The law of attraction in relationship. Strong men can handle powerful women. They're just not attracted to masculine energy. Feminine beings who spend too long in their masculine will end up exhausted, dissatisfied, and numbed out. Bringing the feminine back into life and relationship, understanding the power we have to create enormous spark, desire, and attraction in our relationship is pivotal and the very definition of creating the life you desire. It is the panacea to every cynical version of love, monogamy, and marriage. Marriage is not where a sex life goes to die. Motherhood is not where women lose who they are. But you have to be disoriented with habituation. You have to leave Newtonian versions of reality to step into quantum ones. And both these human experiences of love offer insights and doorways to power and potency. I choose a path less traveled. And sometimes I wonder where the heck I am. But I often think we have to lose ourselves to find ourselves. And in this life and this love I found myself, I would choose over and over again. And the experience of eroticism that lights my soul on fire. And I find myself here with you. And I am grateful for all of it. For all of you. For this opportunity. For the experiences that led me here. For my husband, who honestly, Lord knows how he put up with the book writing version of me in lockdown with four children, homeschool and work. And my children, who have cheered me on at every step, who've babysat their little sisters more times than I can count. Who've gracefully tolerated a mum who's been more distracted and who have shown up every step of the way. Love, hey. I'm grateful to our parents who have helped me out these past few weeks, for friends who rallied, for my business coaches who showed me a path, for the women whose very books changed my own life. And I'm grateful to Amelia, who's my VA, and literally I could not have survived this year without her. I love you too much. And to all the women who've shared their most sacred experiences with me and continue to fan the flames of my heart and soul. Thank you. It is my hope that you find love among the flowers tonight or today, whatever it is for you. So, thank you.
That's beautiful.
It's really hard.
You did so well.
Okay, I'm actually going to read your comments now. Now I can, like, see.
Oh, beautiful. Nicole says, I'm not hearing this with my ears, but feeling this with my heart. Absolutely right. There's a bazillion comments.
Thanks for hanging in there with me for that one. Oh, you're bawling too, Janine. Oh, Lucy. Oh, thank you.
Loved harder and harder again, your courage to do that.
Yeah.
Because that's what it looks like, right?
Yeah.
It's moving toward the hardness.
Mm. Yeah. Because human love is complicated, right? Mm. We're complex humans. It's just marrying or partnering up with literally the pain and the panacea to our soul. Like, that's never going to be easy. We just have this romanticized version of what love is, I think. Aww. Aww, thanks, Eliza. Oh, Sophia. Such a joy for me to read your
drink
comments.
It all
thank
in.
You.
Drink it all in.
Yeah. Oh, thanks, Sandy. Oh, I love Robert Frost too. Oh. Thank you. Mm. Oh, Nicole. Thanks, Elise. Oh, beautiful Dasha. Kisses for Amelia, too. I felt like doing one of those memes that's like, the Klingon is like, you can't ever leave.
What's her thing?
I don't know.
In a grade 5 Klingon or something.
Oh, know? Man. I'm like even beyond. Oh, thanks, Sneakers. Oh, thanks, Catherine. Oh, Sally. Oh, I so love it when you go, I'm crying too. I'm like, oh, good, permission.
You're crying, I'm crying, progress.
It's all good then. Oh, Kasha. Oh, Kylie. Oh, thanks, Sarah. Yeah, indeed, Adele. Marrying the pain to our soul. Mm-hmm. If only we knew that. Back when we started marrying and we think we know what love is. Thank you for traveling that with me. I really appreciate that. And it's really good for me to... Yeah, definitely. It's really good for me to have cried my way through it once. It won't be as brutal tomorrow. So thank you. And thank you for hearing my words. I really, honestly, do feel incredibly grateful just to be here. Thank you. Thank you. All right.
I'd love to ask you some questions.
Yes.
Would that be okay?
I would love you to ask me some questions. And if you have any questions, you're more than welcome to type them.
And I would love to answer them. So in your speech, you talked about being an intimacy revolutionist, which you are.
I know. It's taken me a long time to like...
own it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it was when I was writing that speech, I went, yeah, but it's not revolutionary. Like, it's not revolutionary. It's the oldest teaching in the book. But in a masculine world, that's not...
Yeah, it's forgotten.
No,
it's
yeah.
It's a forgotten art and an undervalued art, and therefore women, because it's they're not seen it as valued, then minimise it
right.
themselves.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's also, your book, what it proposes, is radical. In that, for the empowered woman, there's a sense, well, he should just do this.
Or... Oh.
I'm not because he can't or he won't. And one of the questions was, you know, I had a friend who keeps getting stuck in the he'll never change. I have to do all the work. I hate the patriarchy. They're all the same. And I know that your heart breaks for that woman and that man who she speaks of.
Yeah, well, I really hope you got that from my speech too, because... I probably am not as public about it, but I do work and have worked with men for a really long time. And yeah, I don't know what I want to say about that other than I think we have a version of who they are that is very rarely the truth of who they are. And we simply, it's literally like that most famous of books, isn't it? Men are from Mars, women are from Venus. And we just continuously, we're like shooting stars that bypass each other. And what I wish we knew and what I hope that we teach our children and what is in the book that I hope we then carry on to teach the next evolution of love is a loving that's far more compassionate for how you are and how we are and an understanding of the truth of what the divine masculine is and when it's wounded and hurting and how to move with that, and what the divine feminine is and when it's wounded and hurting and how to move with that. Because if we could see below the very thin veil of behaviors, I mean, we talk about this even with children, right? If we stop at behaviors, we've missed the reason it exists there. And I don't see any relationship as dysfunctional. I see any opportunity for pain and dysfunction to be an opportunity for revelation and discovery. So when you're entering something with the framework of, I'm learning how to love better, how to play a scale that moves up and down and backwards and forwards, and to pick any type of love and be able to play it in it in its full capacity, because that serves us in our parenting, because none of our children want to be loved the same way or in the same moment the same way, do they? And neither does anyone in this world, and our partners included. So whenever we're offered an opportunity to break through what holds us back from love, like what's Rumi's quote on that? You know the one I'm talking about, don't you?
Love is the bridge between you and everything. No,
I can't think of it. It'll come to me. But the concept that you're just here to remove everything that's in the way of love rather than to seek for love. So we often end up in these categories. We attract our perfect equal and opposite, and what we loved about them, we end up hating about them. That's not an accident. That's a divine orchestration. You come together like two opposites. It's a magnetic force of attraction. It's insatiable because you create a type of stability, you know, different to the coming together of protons and electrons. There's a type of stability. Not that they complete you, but you together create a law that underpins every natural law of this universe, opposites and equals that come together, right? But that will work, and you'll outsource those traits until they become the very thing you like hate. And all of a sudden there'll be repulsion and rejection, and things will start to get a bit clunky. And that sense of then repelling, so as opposed to the magnet that brings you together, the magnet that starts to repel you apart is the very reason getting you to self-identify, right? You've had enough of this where you've outsourced your power. Now please take it into yourself. Because when we're merging our energy, we're in the other. When we're in repulsion, propulsion, our energy comes back into ourselves. Mm-hmm. So I see that act as something that's in service to the self, that's in service to growth. And the truth is, actually, we don't want to change. We want to be loved better, but we don't want to have to change because we've changed enough. And we do all the hard work and they do none of the hard work. And all of the reasons that stop us from really entering what is here, which is a rich and vast capacity to understand and experience love with humility, not love with ego attached to it. You've got to be willing to risk it all, to claim it all. And risking it all really isn't about being reckless. It's about letting go of any desire to save face or to hold on to a sense of ego that keeps you separated from love. Again, not a revelationary teaching, because it will be in the underpinnings of any spiritual teaching of love. It's simply that I'm trying to pull that forwards in a way that's more accessible, and I hope makes more sense to the understanding and the bridging between the way that a feminine creature works and the way that a masculine creature works. And that if we want to, one, be loved better is one part of the book, but the other part of the book is all about, and let's have sex and soul passionate experiences that open up even more for both of you, more love, more inspiration, more abundance. Because when we open ourselves up, and there's no force more powerful than sexual energy. So to experience a relationship where it's completely devoid feels like a heartbreak and a soul break for me. And what I'm trying to say is, yeah, but if we come back to the laws of which our entire universe is functioning, and likely will actually be sitting there going, this is, I don't like it, it's annoying, please come back to here. If we learn how to do that, all of a sudden you get this equal and opposite, and there's an arc of electricity. Boom. Chemistry can be back and ignited. So, you know, running Family Inc., running kids, getting the house done, ordering, you know, all the things that need doing in a household, you might be energetically completely neutral. Best friends, amazing colleagues, best founders of Family Inc. But when you then want to be able to create enormous spark and chemistry and desire and attraction and heart-opening, soul and body connecting experiences that make you a better partner and a better, stronger family and presence and force in the world, then you have the opportunity to go, oh, okay, yeah, this is actually just a skill set. I can actually learn. I've learned how to do neutrality, so shit gets done on the mental plane, and I can choose to flip that so that all of a sudden also I can be completely opened and surrendered and experience this other part of my being that just wants to let go, that just wants to be taken and not in control, that just wants to see how far and how wide and how big and how deep I can possibly be. And that experience is just as ecstatic for our partners. But when we've spent a lifetime training them in the opposite way, it's going to take a little bit of training, no different to training a new puppy to do tricks and to sit on the mat and to do all of the things. It takes training to break our neural pathways that just want to keep firing down the same track. It takes a pattern interrupt. So it starts to feel a bit clunky. You feel a bit robotic before it starts to feel silky smooth. And it's going to feel awkward and unusual and like, this doesn't feel super sexy. Where's the sexy part, Julie? And I'm like, yes, I know, but we're pattern interrupting and then it gets sexy. So I just want to bust the whole concept that you can't have love and extreme passion and that you can't run a household of four children as a full-time stay-at-home mum with two businesses, so Bridget and I do Nourishing the Mother together, and I have my business, The Pleasure Nutritionist, as a practitioner. I can't run two businesses, a household that I completely manage, four children with all of the stuff that comes with that, and choose to show up as a conscious parent and conscious lover if I'm not able to flip at will. Because if I'm not flipping at will, I'm going to end up pretty cranky, and I'll just keep suppressing desire until there's nothing going on here. I don't want anything. There's nothing in it. Nothing. And that breaks my heart, because I know the capacity that women have to open and share their force of feminine energy in this world with filling through their own bodies and hearts, which soars up into incredible inspiration, that soars out into incredible connection with their children, and the opportunity to be really held in a partnership, I think really allows you the courageousness to do big things in the world. So
I love that you touched. I mean, there was so much that I loved.
I know, it was a bit much.
No, but there was some amazing stuff. And I want to break down what you said when you said, I can flip at will.
Mm.
Because one of the other questions that came up was, how do you flip from feminine to masculine? For example, I was super feminine the other day, and then a lady came, and I knew that I needed to flip.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I know that that particular woman who wrote that is a practitioner, so she's a naturopath as well. So I think when she's saying a lady came, she's talking about a client. Yeah. So being in the practitioner role, very much like being in the mother role, is a masculine energy role, because you are the master of space and time. You are in charge of the well-being, the bodies, the have you eaten? Have we got all the things done? Are you looked after? Are you safe? Have you got where you need to go? And forward planning. Have I got dinner in place? Who's got to go where? What time are they going to bed? Which means bath needs to happen back here. Like, all of that is a masculine energy art form, because it's vision, it's foresight, it's purpose. It's like a regiment, right? It's a set of tasks that get you there. So if you, and conversely, though, if you are being a practitioner, you also need to be no different to if you're actually holding women's circle. It's very much a masculine space. You've got to hold the energy. Mm-hmm. You've got to hold the container. If you're bubbling and wailing and doing all of the things as much as your kids, who's holding the space? Mm-hmm. Probably they'll end up holding it. No different to in women's circle or with a part, or, you know, wherever. If you're the one bubbling, someone else will be taking on that polarity, because we all influence each other. So if I all of a sudden started, you know, bubbling, probably saw in that even Bridget like became the space of regulation. And if that was the opposite, if Bridget was bubbling away with emotion, I would become the space of holding, so that she could experience that more deeply. So how to flip at will, though, was the question, wasn't it?
Yes.
How to flip at will is to find what your feminine practice is. So I don't, sometimes women need masculine practice. If you're the type of woman who can't see through a goal, who new shiny things, go with the flow, perhaps nourishes so much to the point of her own exhaustion, is unboundaried, then yes, you need more masculine practice to pull. It's like a container for the light. You've got to be able to beam it so we can see light, right? It's a container. But it's fewer. So let's say maybe 15% of women need masculine practice in our culture, because it's so set up.
So well trained.
So well trained in the masculine. Sorry, it's my puppy. Ruby! That could be my big kids coming back from basketball. So what we need is a lot of feminine practice and energy, and that looks like coming back. That's why it's called honey. So I called it flowers and honey, because flowers is the feminine. Honey is that feminine deliciousness that like spills out, that's magnetic and sexy and enticing and attractive. It's that part of you that feels like honey, right? It's like warm and golden and sticky and delicious and sweet and all those things. So you need to find what your feminine practice is, so that you can be masculine practice boundaried enough that you put them in place as the container for you to become feminine. So you've got to have in place a practice that allows you to develop your feminine polarity. Once it's as developed as your masculine, becomes very easy to go, oh, I know that thing's going to get me there. Boom, I'm just going to do that right now. Oh, hello, honey. And now I've learned how to spread it in my body. No different just spreading honey on bread or toast that's hot, right? The more you practice it, the easier it becomes to do. So it's really about finding your feminine practice and then practicing it every day. And it can look like small micro things. So it's talked throughout the book how to develop your own feminine practice, which just looks like feeling more. What is it that has you feeling more? When you feel, you're in your feminine. When you empty and dissolve, you're in your masculine. So what allows you the experience of a sensation, then how can I feel it more and more and more, and how can it bloom in my body and in my heart, and how can I let it be here in such a way that it almost takes me, this sensation itself? So I don't know if that answers it as directly, but what I would say is it starts with really knowing what excites and entices your own feminine, because it will be different for each of us. As long as you're practicing feeling and feeling more and developing your feeling capability, you will then come to a point where that muscle is strong enough that you can just go, I'm just going to do that now because right now I want him to look at me. Boom, I'll do that. I'm really like, I could be here in the kitchen going, fuck, I really just wish he would like look at me and just like take me right now, and he's instead flaked out in front of the TV or something. Then instead of going to him, instead of being the one who initiates, instead of any of those things, I'll just turn on my feminine and he's like a radar. What's happened over there? And I haven't said a thing. Because that is the power of a magnetic force in the world. It's literally like a positive and a negative magnet. You can't keep them apart. It's a force of attraction that creates everything. Gravity, electricity, like anything and everything, weather currents, right? It's not something that's said. It's a magnetic force of attraction that happens. So I don't do anything to him. I learn the fact that I'm dissatisfied in this moment means, oh, this is my practice. I'm not happy. Because remember, it's manifestation, right? What you put out will equate what you get back. And in the law of attraction, if you want desire, you have to be opposite. If you want neutrality, be the same. So if I want a best friend, cool to be the same. But if I want to be deeply taken and all sorts of incredible things done to my heart, body, and soul, then I have to be opposite. So in this moment, I go, oh, let's switch that key, switch that note. Maybe I haven't done that today.
And that in itself is an amazing and powerful unlearning of everything that women will have grown up with, because it's all about the power of your communication. You know, we're cultured to be communicators and to approach things from our head, but that goes nowhere fast in terms of evoking the masculine who desires to take you.
Yeah.
Right.
Totes.
And it leads to dissatisfaction. Totes. And retreat from, you know, closure from a woman and hurt. And yet this energetic practice that you're talking about is the game changer. So yeah. I love that you've outlined it so beautifully in the book.
Well, it sounds like magic, but really it's not. It's literally just a force of nature. We literally live in it every day. So you don't need a reminder. Well, if you need a reminder, look to any of that. Drop something. Watch how it falls to the floor. Put two magnets together and remind yourself. It's everywhere. Electricity every time you flick on a light.
I love that. I love this question. What was your life before you didn't do this work? And what steps and pathways did you take to get where you are? So I think the steps and pathways will be what you've just talked about in terms of learning your feminine. But what was life like before you didn't do this work?
It was way harder. It was way more brutal. Life before I did this work looked like me being pretty shitty and pretty angry at Nick. It's my husband. Pretty angry. Nick and I have been together. I've been married. Holy moly. Been married nearly 15 years. So we've been together nearly 20. This is a really long time. So me pre that just looked like, oh shit, so I've had babies and I must be unattractive now. I must be now undesirable. The fact that he's flaked out on the couch and not paying attention to me means that I'm not desirable. And then insert the culmination of body shame, eating disorders, self-flagellation and berating, an inner critic off the Richter scale that was as harsh as any slave master, and then turning that around into, well, fuck you, and this like nastiness that would come out. So either he was exactly as I wanted him to be, which then meant I was okay, or he wasn't giving me or wasn't what I wanted him to be, in which case it meant I wasn't okay or he wasn't okay. And so it looked like a lot of things. It looked like a lot of hurt and anger. It looked like a lot of misunderstanding. I mean, that's later. It looked like I understand I was misunderstanding, but it looked like a lot of me thinking it was because I'd had babies and now I wasn't this, you know, sexy little sphinx or something like that anymore, which is not true. And it looked like we've tried counseling. We've tried the doing, so tried all of the things. So I do think when you're trying to find a new sex life, you've got to try a lot of things. You've got to try the ill fitting and the good fitting. but I would like that to come from a place of embodiment, not performance. So I recognized that I was not coming from a place of embodiment, because of course that was what was missing for me back then, was the feminine. I was highly masculinized. So I was looking for the things, the vibrator, the up and up of what is supposed to be a more, I don't know, performative style of sex, or I've tried all of it. But it looked like trying to do the things that still didn't really make me feel
so
anything.
So I was seeking things from outside of you to have the answer.
Yeah, totes. And it looked like berating him for being an insufficient lover, for clearly, it looked like me getting really angry and pissed off at the fact that he couldn't, he clearly wasn't doing it right to make me feel something. Like, I don't know, like the full spectrum of all of that. But how I could sum that up is just enormous pain. Like, God, that was so much harder than the life I live now. Like, way harder. Because it was this, like, up and down and up and down. And that is, like, emotionally exhausting. So what I find now is the self-responsibility that comes with that. That's like, oh, so if I want that, it's my reminder. So if I desire something to be different to what it is right now in this moment, it's literally my reminder to get in my feminine. It's literally how I look at it. It doesn't mean I can't have it. It doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It doesn't mean anything about them, and it doesn't mean anything about me. In this moment, all it is my reminder, get in your feminine. I'm like, oh, great. Because the second I get in my feminine, anything my heart wants is up. But if I'm trying to do it from the masculine, my heart isn't connected and I'm not going to experience it anyway.
That's beautiful.
Hi, Carly.
Nicole says you so have to teach us a couple sacred sex class or retreat someday.
Yeah, I would really love to do that one day. I have been thinking about it. I'm actually at the moment converting my garage into a space, like a studio space, so that I can run small. Because I really actually, this 2020 has kept us all very, you know, separated physically. And I'm a healer. I just want to get my hands on people's bodies. So I'm really looking forward to having intimate sessions there.
Beautiful. Now, I love this question too, because this can be what one of the biggest things for feminine hurt, as I understand it, is the perception of the masculine kind of withdrawing, and that the feminine sees in that, I'm not worthy, I'm not good enough, you know, a lot of what you recounted. But this question says, I'd love to know that if a masculine craves to be empty, how is this achieved in your relationship with Nick? What practice do you have in place so that your beautiful masculine man is able to refuel and replenish?
Yeah, okay. So I recognize with Nick that he requires time out. So I'll watch him. I think one of the key things is to actually look, and we talk about it in this book, about where can you see him on mission or on task? Because if you can see that he's currently trying to provide something, but he's currently on mission, like the knight in shining armor trying to do something, it allows you to go, oh, look, he's not doing nothing right now. His focus is dinner, dishes, getting out the door to work, to kids' basketball games, to whatever, which won't even be the thing. They'll be in service to the bigger overarching value, which might actually be you. It might actually be, when I do these things, I'm making a more harmonious relationship. I'm doing this for the woman that I love. I'm doing this to look after our home, to provide for our home, to provide for our family, which will be likely a shared value between the two of you. So I think that it has to start first with seeing how he's on mission, because often we stop seeing it and we start judging because it's not exactly in the form that we would do it or we want to see it. And so it starts this values projection, which means you're running a video camera, you're running a movie onto a screen, and he's the screen, and you can't even see the screen because all you're seeing is your own movie. So you have to get really used to switching off your screen or values projection and going, ah, What is he in service of right now? What is the mission that he's on right now? Because when I see that and I can see the degree of difficulty, because of course there's a degree of difficulty depending on what their task is doing, and the bigger the degree of difficulty, the bigger the need for rest and replenishment at the other side. So they're an equal scale. So if it's only a minor task, he's like put the dishwasher away or something, I'm like, ah, oh, he's fine, he'll just, you know, stand and check his phone for a second, put it down and he's off, or stand and have a conversation with me, because the feminine can be just as replenishing for the masculine. Don't forget, feminine energy is completely revitalizing and nourishing. Like, think about the feminine in any capacity. Think about how it feels to be greeted by a friend that you love and you could have been feeling shit a second before, and all of a sudden you're like, oh, I feel so much better just being around your presence. I'm going to pay to plug into that musician's live music concert. I'm going to pay to be in your energy as a coach. I'm going to go for a walk on the beach and feel the waves as they move around my body, or feel the wind as it moves through what feels like my soul. They're all forms of the feminine, and we feel revitalized and replenished because the feminine is life. So you can be that when you're in your feminine. So the moment I take my feminine energy and move towards my partner or invite him into mine, it's like a dip in the wellspring of life for him. Mm-hmm. And you can literally watch him like come back to life again. I'm like, oh, he's good to go again. Fantastic. Mm-hmm. What do I desire next? Mm-hmm. Or it can be, I recognize, like, we've just, because I'm converting the garage, we've had to put up two shades and it's taken us like 2 weekends. Really massive job. So I've watched him absolutely work super hard to get this really big task done. So I know that night he just wants to flake out, have a beer, talk, maybe watch a bit of sport. Sport's very revitalizing. Talk about sport, very revitalizing. Be in his top values. So maybe that's hanging with the kids, watching a movie, or hanging with me, sitting next to him. So it looks like having a deep compassion for what do you need as a replenishment. Now, either I'm bringing the feminine energy and I'll replenish you, because that feels really good for me. It's not about doing it for him. It's about the fact that I get to be this. And the better I feel, the better you're going to feel. Mm-hmm. And that's just the way that it works. It's that you are the wellspring of life. Or it looks like, you know, I'm not really feeling like that. I actually am really happy to be neutral or in my own little flake out masculine zone. And that feels really beautiful for my heart and body right now. Mm. Cool. Then I'm going to remove any expectation that he's supposed to be, or I'm supposed to be, or we're supposed to be any different. Mm. And in which case I'm going to enjoy this and let him do whatever the heck he wants. Flake out on the couch, watch the sport, scroll on his phone, have a nap. Mm. Whatever that looks like, go fishing with the boys. Because either he's choosing your feminine to replenish, or he will choose the feminine in another form. Feminine is form. Mm-hmm. He will choose to go fishing and be revitalized by the ocean and her breezes, tussle with her currents because he's not tussling with yours. Mm-hmm. Go for a run and see how far he can run and how much heat he can feel. Go polish his car and smooth over her behind until it's shining and he feels magnificent about it. Mm. Right? Like, either he's choosing your feminine or he's choosing whatever is available to him. Mm. And you actually get to choose what you want. You get to choose whether you wish to be the focus of his feminine. Other way around.
Yeah. His feminine focus.
Yeah. Or you're like, I'm really sweet here and I can love you doing your thing, and that's so cool. So I can watch my husband, like, sport isn't really my thing, but bless his cotton socks, it is very much my husband's thing. And there are plenty of women in sport who we, you know, obviously he coaches in my daughter's basketball team and in my son's, heaps of mums, heaps of incredible women athletes. And I'm like, please go fill him up on that. I have no desire and I'm really happy here and I'm really happy to watch you fill up and I'm really happy to have that filled up version of my husband back. And I've got to do whatever the heck I want to do here. Like, it's, there's no meaning attached to it. It's just a feminine replenishment. I know how that feels. Like writing this book, I wrote this book, if you don't know, in three days, because it's actually the first book that I wrote, I decided to change and create this book, and that's probably books 2 and 3 in one. It was too big and too deep. Much like this. So when I was like full force pouring this like super masculine, climbing Mount Everest, writing this book, my husband was in his full feminine, bringing me food, bringing me nourishment, rubbing my shoulders. How else can I keep you nourished so that you can do this, you know, force in the world that you need to be right now? Like, it's not about men and women. So completely remove any attachment that you have to men being powerful and women being subservient. It's completely not attached to men and women. It's not attached to gender or genitals at all. It's a spectrum within all of us. And you can have men that are incredibly feminine, and you can have women that are the most masculine being in the room. It's not about genitals. It's literally about a state of being. And I can go and be replenished by a beautiful feminine creature sitting next to me, or the ocean, or my children, or my own body and soul, or my husband if he's in his feminine. And that can feel delicious and wonderful and incredible. We receive when someone nourishes us. We receive when someone gives us a present, a gift, cooks us a meal that we just adore, when we bathe in sunlight, you know, like, we receive. So I don't judge anybody's need to receive and replenish, and I fully recognize that I have the power to claim that space at any time I want. So do I want to, or do I not? Because that's the self-responsible part.
Beautiful answer. I'm seeing what else I've got here. It's probably all that I want to cover. I think probably this is a big one too, because it's easy for people to get caught up in this idea that you are always nailing this, right? This question here says,
yeah.
A simple one, but how do I remember to stay in the work or practice of energy? Because obviously we all come with like the mental stories and the other stuff that gets in the way. So do you have certain reminders that you use to remember the practice of this energy movement?
Look, to be honest with you, for me, I think I've proved it to myself enough that I can't believe my own bullshit anymore. So all of the mental stuff that says, oh, I can't be bothered, oh, he's so, I'm so, I always, he never, I've just moved beyond that, because I've proved the opposite true too many times now that I can't unsee it anymore. And I think it will be the same for you.
So the moment you hear yourself say, he's always, you're going, nope.
No, he's not. Yeah. Why do I need this right now?
Yeah.
I am doing that mental work. And at the same time, I literally know in the deepest part of me that whatever I desire, I can have. Literally. So if I desire something, I just need to get in the energetic frequency of that. And I know that sounds like I've heard it talked about. So, I mean, it's very pop culture now, isn't it? Let's face it. I don't know that we really understand what that means on an energetic level, but I think you can practice it and find that out in relationship. If I perceive that in this moment he is anything disappointing or dissatisfying to me in this moment, then I just turn that mirror back this way.
Yeah.
And I go, oh, you're dissatisfied and displeased at the moment. What would you really like to be right now? Instead of what we like to do is feel the pain and go, it's because of you, because you're so, as opposed to, oh, I really want, crave, desire. How can I, if you want to be desired, get into the frequency of desire. It's like a done deal. The moment you are the frequency of desire. If you wish to feel more pleasure, get into the frequency of pleasure. What is pleasure in your body? What is desire in your body, in your heart, in your mind? How would desire move right now? How would desire sit? How would desire move her jaw? How would she move her tongue in her mouth? How would she stand in front of her partner? Because the moment you do that, everything you want, you're just in the energetic frequency of it. But I can't be the energetic frequency of fuck you and expect I'm going to be just desired into like some sort of rapture. different frequencies, and I get to choose. Am I enjoying my fuck you right now? In which case, I'm just going to stay here and revel in it. Or am I ready to let that go and change what I'm doing? Change what you're doing, you get a different result. Stay with what you're doing, you've got the reality of that frequency. It's really that simple. So when I realize I'm out of alignment with what I desire, if I'm not really in this moment going, this is everything I want it to be in this moment, I couldn't ask for it to be different because I'm in it, I'm feeling it. Then I go, oh, you get to choose. Do you want that or that? I go, oh, no, I want this. This is good. I'm going to do this. It's literally just a reminder for me because I know wholeheartedly that the masculine around me, the masculine in my son, the masculine in my daughter, the masculine in my husband, wants nothing more than to be of service and to provide and grow their sense of self through that provision. So there's literally nothing blocking what I desire other than me. But if I want it, I have to be the energetic frequency to attract it, and then I have to let it in. I can't just yell out for it and then put up the blockades and go, mm-mm, not feeling it. No, that was very disappointing.
I just want to check some of these questions. And I want to remind people, if you're wanting to get the launch special, to be making sure that you are.
So it is a launch special. So today and tomorrow, you can pick up my book for $25 off my website with free postage. Otherwise, you will find it for something around $25 on Amazon. They get to pick their own price point, which is wonderful.
I'm just going to drop the link again for people.
Thank you. And you can also upgrade to a launch special, which includes, I've put together some really beautiful additional bonuses for you if you choose to jump into some launch love. So there's some, you get the ebook straight away, instant download. There's some about four meditations, I think. And I did some beautiful screensavers too, if you'd like to jump into those. I would also love to say that if you can, please leave me a reminder, a review on Amazon, that I've put together. The artworks from my book are actually by Rose Amara. I don't know if you've been following me on socials or not, but she does the most incredible channeled works.
They're so beautiful.
Oh my gosh, they're so beautiful. And so what I've put, I'll just show you a couple of them. So there's the Divine Feminine, other way, Divine Feminine Flower. So I've put together a instantly downloadable as well, mindful coloring book with a few prompts with all of these. So it's like they're mandalas. They're designed to put you into a meditative state. I'll show this mandala at the end for relationship. And for you to contemplate and receive revelations by virtue of getting into that state. So when you leave me a review, just let me know and I will send you, that's the mandala. Isn't that incredible? It's the sun and the moon.
It's gorgeous.
So let me know when you've left a review on Amazon and I will send you a link to instantly download the book, and you can do that with yourself or your kids or whatever feels really good. You might want to journal about it and pop it in. And then if you leave a review for the month of December, you will go into a very special draw to win a spot in my Queen's School, which will be launching on the 28th of December. So on Christmas Eve, I will be drawing that. So that's worth $1,111 to jump into Queen's School with me. So if you leave a review, you go into the running for that. If you purchase the launch special, which is $25 free postage for a signed copy of my book today or tomorrow, and that's the only time it's going to be up. After that, it goes up to $39, which is the stock standard signed copy price. Then you will go into the running tonight with Bridget, and we're going to draw it tonight for 3 one-on-one coaching spots with me and 2 1 month in Honey Club for free, which is a beautiful Divine Feminine dive in.
So I'd love you to just tell me, we've got some orders coming through. Yes. So I'd love to add those names because we'll draw that in very shortly, I think.
Yes. Sorry, my bad.
No, that's good.
Not sure who we got up to. Do you remember?
Oh, there's been a couple here. Yeah, all right. So we might get you to write some special messages to some of these people that have...
Oh, that's a great idea.
Can we get another pen?
Let's do that. Yes.
Cool.
I went and purchased a special pen. It was quite an ordeal because I had to make sure it wasn't going to smudge as I was writing.
Where have we got? Annie Taylor. He's just quoted. She must be watching. I didn't see any comments from Annie. Okay.
I'm going to write to you, my beautiful Annie.
So if you also want a special message written right now, now's the time to order. So we are watching them coming through.
Darling Annie, may you walk among the flowers. Be dazzled by the bees.
Sophie Brock has ordered hers tonight too. Oh,
Sophie. And find the honey. All my love.
Thank you, Julia. Julia Poppleton's order just came through. Jules. Thanks, Jules. Katie.
I've also ordered some very special printed paper, wrapping paper. It's going to go in here with my really beautiful, also ordered out of the artwork. So you'll see your book will arrive covered in the most glorious divine feminine. It's that flower at the start. Let's see if I can find it again. Ordered printed paper of that image all over it, and I'll be stamping it with the beautiful queen bee. It's also part of the flowers and honey image that Rose drew, that's in gold, and you will have a flower there too. So it will arrive covered in flowers and honey for you, darling Annie, with your little bubba. Let me find it. Cannot find it. Perhaps not. Doesn't matter. We'll keep going. If you have a question, I'm more than happy to write it to you. This one's for you, beautiful Sophie. Dearest Sophie, you dazzle and delight this world. You do, don't deny it.
Kim Bowman just ordered.
Aww, thanks, Kim.
This is a bit fun, seeing these come it through and fun, getting to write, it? To write messages. Oh, yes, we found yours, Ange. Ange's order came through too.
Thank you, beautiful Ange. May love find you.
Yes, yeah, yes. If you pre-ordered already, if you pre-ordered a paper copy, you're already in the draw.
Yeah.
Tracy, I can't wait to get this. What else have we got?
Oh, my love. This is for you, Soph. I feel like you need to hear it now. Dearest Sophie, you dazzle and delight this world. May love find you every place you walk. All my love, Jules. Maybe you needed to hear that.
Order just come through from Alison.
Aww, thanks, Alison.
So I'm going to start. You can keep ordering for the next couple of minutes, and then we're going to get ready to do this draw.
Yeah, that'd be amazing. If you've got any questions, also, you're more than welcome to ask me. I would love to answer any of your questions, really. I honestly just feel incredibly lucky just to be here with you, really. And incredibly lucky to have this book. And I'm going to say, I feel really grateful that you all stuck through my tears.
It was beautiful. They are a gift.
My writing to Alison.
Katie Parker.
Katie Parker, stop it. Hello, my love. Let me think about you, Alison. You need to miss a bit louder. It's a good song. Do you remember this from 100 years ago?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Darling Allison, you are light. You are love. You are life. Remember. No, but I am, and okay, I've got to have a think about you too. Hang on.
Yeah, we've got you on here, Nicole, too. Do you want to write on to Nicole after you've written one?
Yeah, Ange? I will. I'm just going to tune in to Ange for a minute. Do you want a texter? Have a texter.
Yeah, that'll work. Thank you. I don't know who Graham Ellis Williams is, but it's somebody who's watching now.
Oh, I feel like I should know that because I've seen your PayPal come up many times.
Jessica Crawford? Is that another one that just came through? Liz Breen?
Oh, thanks for Liza. Dearest Anne. Do you not want me to say yours out loud? I keep getting this like, open. No, just kidding. Yes, I do. No, just kidding. All right. I'll keep yours a secret. You just get to read it. Yes, Amy, yours came through too. I wrote yours earlier. It's in.
Vicky, if you just scroll up a little bit higher into the comments, you'll see the link. I might try to drop it again.
Oh,
the link
thank again. You.
That's not mine.
This is why it takes a team. Aren't women just amazing?
I've just dropped the link again if others want to order and be in the draw for our giveaway. We're going to be drawing very, very soon. Yeah.
So there's five. So it's 3 one-on-one sessions with me and 2 1 month in Honey Club with me as well, where we do lots of divine feminine opening and trying to find and discover your feminine practice and lots of learning through group coaching. I often think it's in the questions and the finding of solutions that you find your own answers. Mm. I think that's the power of sharing stories as women, isn't it? Music.
Mm, isn't it? Orders just come through for Cindy Ben as well.
Aww.
Beautiful Cindy. And Kezia Easter.
Aww. Thanks.
Dasha ordering all the copies. Beautiful candy. This has to be like the gift, right? The gift for friends and in relationship and even not in relationship, to understand relationship.
I hope so. I don't know if you know, but I had a dedication to my children in the front, and it's for that reason, because I hope our children read it one day too. Shall I read it to you now? It says, for my children, hang on, I'll just turn that funky music down. For my children, may you one day find this book on a shelf of wisdom. Pick it up and open the pages. May you feel my beating heart yearning to whisper truths to you. May you smell the baked goods and hear the laughter we shared over so many years in the very space I wrote this book. May you tuck its wisdom into your pocket of golden nuggets and carry it forward into creating the life of love you were born to experience. I love you. Thank you for sharing your life with me.
Oh, God, I love that.
Well, then you'll love my end one in the conclusion. Let me read you that also. Hang on.
in the end, very end. You'll miss it if you don't look. For my children, please know my loves. Love exists all around you. Don't give up on love ever, even when you're hurt, especially when you're hurt. Return to love again and again. Do not mistake human romanticized love for soul love. The divine brings us love in all its shades. The soul seeks love to guide our growth. Often our revelations are born out of pain. Look for the lesson, seek the growth. It's all on the way, not in the way. Awaken what love guides you towards. You may have the courage, may you have the courage to leap, falling into faith, because you have trust in your own heart and a proven inner knowing that you'll build your wings on the way. May your relationships be as deeply fulfilling as ours is and was, and may you know how to guide it when it falls short. Love, honor, and respect lead to an exceptional life. Go create yours. May love fill the pages of your life's journey. Soul deep love and gratitude, Mum. Ah, family's a top value.
Beautiful. Okay.
And I'm still writing yours, but I promise you I won't read it out. Because I think it's in here. Yes, if you also go into this, you'll see that I'll send you some emails, and I think it's the next email you get that has a link to my Flowers and Honey, the book playlist. And I'm not kidding, it is a playlist full of songs literally about honey, that say honey, that are titled honey, or flowers.
Quite a fun little
It's actually fantastic. There's even a song called Flowers and Honey.
Really?
I'm not even joking.
No way.
Yes, there is.
That is so cool.
So that is what we're playing right now. You don't know whether to be excited or scared. I felt like that's what I was getting for you, was like this. There you go, Ange. I'll even kiss it. Who should I write to now? Katie? Or did you tell me someone else?
Katie before? Wrote Katie. Cindy.
Oh, Cindy. I'm writing to you next, Cindy. Hang on. All right, Cindy, are you ready? Dearest Cindy, may you fill your heart with flowers, taste honey dripping from your lips, and know you are exactly where you're meant to be. All my love, Jules.
I'm going to keep dropping a link to the book for people who are asking.
Cool. I'm just going to grab a few more books. Hang on, I didn't actually bring a box. Oh, no, I've got one here. I'm good.
Oh, thank you, Megan. Megan's helping helping out, dropping the link.
Oh, Meekin! Bless your cotton socks. Don't know if Meekin and Sophie have connected, but you guys should. Oh, Stephanie Jades would have come through, or Stephanie Ho. Yeah.
Yeah. Just seeing what else seems to be. Anything that was earlier than this recording has already been added.
Yeah, you're already in it, Thomas. I put you in earlier.
Do you want to write to Katie?
I do, but I'm going to have some more. Why not?
Why not?
It's delicious. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Thanks. Oh, that's so yum.
So you've got about 2 more minutes if you want to get an order in and go in the draw for the giveaway.
Yep. Who did you say I was writing to just then?
Katie?
Honest to Cindy, yes.
Yes, Tui, she's writing in books.
Hello, darling Tui. Yes, I saw your orders. You're in as well. So what we're doing here is we've just got that special, that $25 with the free postage, which is slightly different for you because you're in New Zealand, which made it $35. So there was an international postage on it. And I know I'm sending you a refund because I can't actually in PayPal change how many postages you have, which is really annoying. So that's on its way to you as well. So you're in, I promise. You're in the draw. So it's 3 by 1-on-1 sessions with me and 2 by 3 months in Honey Club.
So good. And Nikki, yes, your order came through too. Nikki O'Brien.
Aww, beautiful Nikki. You haven't listened to Nikki's podcast, it's also wonderful. Quintessential being.
I'll let you finish that and then we're gonna get drawing.
All right, let's do it. I think you want to rip those ones up too.
Oh, yeah, cool. Your voice is just so delicious it sent me to sleep.
I'm never sure whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. You'd be surprised how many times I hear that. Mm-hmm. And I'm always like, huh, is that a good thing?
Susan Holland.
Oh, Susan.
Jessica Willman just ordered a book.
Oh, thanks, Jess. Katie Parker. For some reason I feel like I need to keep your message private too. But it comes with a lot of love. It's for you.
Shauna? Oh, no,
that's just the upgrade for the Launch Love special that comes with additional bonuses. Cool. Yeah. all sorts of amazing downloads and screensavers. And I would show you on my phone in a minute, but I made up a whole lot of, so you can put them on your backdrop of your phone.
So cool.
Yeah, really cool. Using again the artwork and just some beautiful feminine reminders, because don't we all need those? In a world that seeks to unfeminize us.
Mm.
All right, Desk, I'm going to write to you. Right, just ready to hear yours. Dearest Jessica, may you dance with flowers in your hair and remember the wildflower you are. All my love, Tools.
Mm.
Hopefully that means something to you. Are we ready to draw? Do you think?
I think I'm ready to draw.
Let's do it with this music.
Let's do it.
Perfect. All right. I know.
All right.
But you're all enjoying it.
Can
you
put a bit of a
sauce? Yeah. I'm gonna really
get in there.
Not that big.
Really?
Let's make sure it's really mixed up.
All right. So the first 30-minute coaching.
Yes. Let's go with the first one-on-one. Goes to Gabriel Petros. I'm going to write these down and we'll make sure we get in contact with you with your email address that's in PayPal. So make sure that you know how to access that email address or message me. All right, next coaching, one-on-one with me. So we get to do anything that your little heart desires. Elise Green.
Ooh.
Well, I see you before your baby. All right, coaching number three, and then we have two for Honeybug. Well, this one then. Lena Latu. Latouse, would you?
Latouse?
I'm probably not saying it right. By all means, correct me. But Lena, I will see you for a one-on-one too. So, Gabriel, Elise, and Lena, I will see you for one on one, which is delicious. I trust that divine timing. So, we have two for Honey Club. So, let's find them. You draw them.
All right. No, I don't.
Perfect music is heard. You want me to hold it?
Kezia Easter.
Welcome. Honey Club. We will get you into Honey Club.
Webster.
Are you already in Honey Club? Hang on. We will get you a free month anyway. Let's
yes,
do that.
There we go.
If you're not already in there, we will get you a free month. That sounds amazing. So thank you very much for those. Just remember, if you leave a review on Amazon and you let me know, I will instantly send you the download for the Mindful Meditation Coloring Book with all of the mandala images that are within the book, which are a channeled artwork by Rose Amara. So please let me know once you've left a review. I'll send you the link straight away. You can print it off and you can just let your feminine mind answer some questions, do some conscious journaling around what the feminine, the masculine is within you and your relationship, and just let whatever wants to come through for you. That's how we find our answers. And then you leave a review, I put you into the draw, which I draw on Christmas Eve to go into the running to win a spot in Queen's School with me, which is starting on the 28th of December. So I will let you know, and that's worth $1,111. So 11-11. So as soon as you leave a review, you go into the draw for that. So
be sure
I would really
to do
appreciate
that.
It. Yeah.
Well, congratulations, Julie.
Thank you.
Because what an achievement. Like, just
Yeah, it is.
Amazing. And I'm sure everybody here is just sending beaming love to you and for this creation, and enormous gratitude too for all of the ways in which you touch women and heal relationships and change stories, right?
Thanks. I really just wanted to end on some sort of releasing ceremony. So here I have my tray. Because I really wanted all of us to have the opportunity to use group energy, because it's always more manifest when we do it together, to call in and release into the world something. I want to be able to be like, here you go, this baby that I've created, right? Like, just like any of our children and any of our businesses, they come through us, but they are not of us, and they have a life of their own and their own divine purpose and place of being in this world, same as any desire that you have. So I would love for you to think about what it is that you're wanting to really, like, almost kiss and send out to the world, what you're wanting to put out there, what you're wanting to attract and call in. And I'm going to light that for all of us and really signify that as a group of collective women who come together, we have an opportunity and an immense power to really send a high vibe message out to the universe. And when we get to do that together, I think would be really beautiful. So do you mind if I borrow that red texter, and I'm going to write on and have a think about what it is that you would really love to send out into the world. Like, it's like, mwah, here you go. This is it. This is leaving me to have a life of its own, to manifest, to grow like a child of mine. Hopefully you're thinking about it like bridges. You know, you can even, if it feels really good for you, gather anything that you have. So it could be a crystal, it could be a ring, it could be something symbolic that you can charge right now with your intention, and you can place somewhere in your home to remind you, and you reaffirm every time you see it, because it's not an accident that your eyes fall upon it. Or you can plant it into Mother Earth and send it deep down into nourishing her, or to literally growing the seeds of the life that you're calling in or wanting to spread out. So if you want to really take something now, you can. And then we'll light ours into the world and celebrate with you in just a moment. Hang on, I'm just going to move that a little bit annoying. Now, they can be finicky, so if it doesn't light straight away, let me move these things so it's not so cluttering, and we'll just do it again. Often it means it was the wrong affirmation. Alright, so I really want all of us to think about what the baby is that we're sending out into the world. Baby's the wrong word. What we would like to release, set an intention for. Going to change the music. Sending love, flowers, feminine beings, and honey, desire and juiciness, and all those exciting moments that you get to have in a human body. Releasing for all of you, whatever your creation is in the world. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna try again. Wrong affirmation. Let's go again. To get in the energetic vibration of whatever you want to call in. Very much for being here for this journey, for helping me celebrate and release out into the world, for saying yes to relationships, strengthening and expanding your life, your heart, your world, and your experience of humanity, because I think it can supercharge anything that we wish to experience and can be a vehicle to any part of growth and abundance that we wish to call in. So it is my hope and my prayer that you seek for flowers. And you find honey. Thank you for being here tonight. Big love to you.